Chapter 9, Section 2 of Capital, Volume 1. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, visit LibriVox.org. Capital, A Critical Analysis of Capitalist Production, Volume 1, by Karl Marx. Translated from the third German edition by Samuel Moore and Edward Aveling, and edited by Friedrich Engels. Part 3, The Production of Absolute Surplus Value. Chapter 9, The Rate of Surplus Value. Section 2, The Representation of the Components of the Value of the Product by Corresponding Proportional Parts of the Product Itself. Let us now return to the example by which we were shown how the capitalist converts money into capital. The product of a working day of 12 hours is 20 pounds of yarn, having a value of 30 shillings. No less than 8/10 of this value, or 24 shillings, is due to mere reappearance in it, of the value of the means of production. 20 pounds of cotton, value 20 shillings, and spindle worn away, 4 shillings. It is therefore constant capital. The remaining 2/6, or 6 shillings, is the new value created during the spinning process. Of this, 1/2 replaces the value of the day's labor power, or the variable capital. The remaining half constitutes a surplus value of 3 shillings. The total value, then, of the 20 pounds of yarn is made up as follows. 30 shillings value of yarn equals 24 shillings constant plus 3 shillings variable plus 3 shillings surplus. Since the whole of this value is contained in the 20 pounds of yarn produced, it follows that the various components parts of this value can be represented as being contained respectively in corresponding parts of the product. If the value of 30 shillings is contained in 20 pounds of yarn, then 8/10 of this value, or the 24 shillings that form its constant part, is contained in 8/10 of the product, or in 16 pounds of yarn. Of the latter, 13 1/3 represent the value of the raw material, the 20 shillings worth of cotton spun, and 2 2/3 pounds represents the 4 shillings worth of spindle, and etc., worn away in the process. Hence, the whole of the cotton used up in spinning the 20 pounds of yarn is represented by 13 1/3 pounds of yarn. This latter weight of yarn contains, it is true, by weight, no more than 13 1/3 pounds of cotton, worth 13 1/3 shillings, but the 6 2/3 shillings additional value contained in it are the equivalent for the cotton consumed in spinning the remaining 6 2/3 pounds of yarn. The effect is the same as if those 6 2/3 pounds of yarn contained no cotton at all, and the whole 20 pounds of cotton were as concentrated in the 13 1/3 pounds of yarn. The latter weight, on the other hand, does not contain an atom, either of the value of the auxiliary materials and implements, or of the value newly created in the process. In the same way, the 2 2/3 pounds of yarn, in which the 4 shillings, the remainder of the constant capital, is embodied, represents nothing but the value of the auxiliary materials and instruments of labor consumed in producing the 20 pounds of yarn. We have, therefore, arrived at this result. Although 8/10 of the product, or 16 pounds of yarn, is, in its character of an article of utility, just as much the fabric of the spinner's labor as the remainder of the same product, yet when viewed in this connection, it does not contain and has not absorbed any labor expended during the process of spinning. It is just as if the cotton had converted itself into yarn without help, as if the shape it had assumed was mere trickery and deceit. For so soon as our capitalist sells it for 24 shillings, and with the money replaces his means of production, it becomes evident that this 16 pounds worth of yarn is nothing more than so much cotton and spindle waste in disguise. On the other hand, the remaining 2/10 of the product, or 4 pounds of yarn, represent nothing but the new value of 6 shillings created during the 12 hours spinning process. All the value transferred to those 4 pounds from the raw material and instruments of labor consumed was, so to say, intercepted in order to be incorporated into the 16 pounds first spun. In this case, it is as if the spinner had spun 4 pounds of yarn out of air, or as if he had spun them without the aid of cotton and spindles, that, being the spontaneous gift of nature, transferred no value to the product. Of this 4 pounds of yarn, in which the whole of the value newly created during the process is condensed, 1/2 represents the equivalent for the value of labor consumed, or the 3 shillings variable capital, the other half represents the 3 shillings surplus value. Since 12 working hours of the spinner are embodied in 6 shillings, it follows that in yarn of the value of 30 shillings, there must be embodied 60 working hours. And this quantity of labor time does in fact exist in the 20 pounds of yarn, for in 8/10, or 16 pounds, there are materialized the 48 hours of 10 labor expended, before the commencement of the spinning process, on the means of production, and in the remaining 2/10, or 4 pounds, there are materialized the 12 hours' work done during the process itself. On a former page we saw that the value of the yarn is equal to the sum of the new value created during the production of that yarn, plus the value previously existing in the means of production. It has now been shown how the various component parts of the value of the product, parts that differ functionally from each other, may be represented by corresponding proportional parts of the product itself. To split up in this manner the product into different parts, of which one represents only the labor previously spent on the means of production, or the constant capital, another only the necessary labor spent during the process of production, or the variable capital, and another and last part only the surplus labor expended during the same process, or the surplus value, to do this, is, as will be seen later on from its application to complicated and hitherto unsolved problems, no less important than it is simple. In the preceding investigation, we have treated the total product as the final result, ready for use, of a working day of 12 hours. We can, however, follow this total product through all the stages of its production, and in this way we shall arrive at the same result as before, if we represent the partial products, given off at the different stages, as functionally different parts of the final or total product. The spinner produces in 12 hours 20 pounds of yarn, or in 1 hour 1 2/3 pounds. Consequently, he produces in 8 hours 12 2/3 pounds, or a partial product equal in value to all the cotton that is spun in a whole day. In like manner, the partial product of the next period of 1 hour 36 minutes is 2 2/3 pounds of yarn. This represents the value of the instruments of labor that are consumed in 12 hours. In the following hour and 12 minutes, the spinner produces 2 pounds of yarn worth 3 shillings, a value equal to the whole value he creates in his 6 hours' necessary labor. Finally, in the last hour and 12 minutes, he produces another 2 pounds of yarn, whose value is equal to the surplus value created by his surplus labor during half a day. This method of calculation serves the English manufacturer for everyday use. It shows, he will say, that in the first 8 hours, or 2/3 of the working day, he gets back the value of his cotton, and so on for the remaining hours. It is also a perfectly correct method, being in fact the first method given above with this difference, that instead of being applied to space, in which the different parts of the completed product lie side by side, it deals with time, in which those parts are successively produced. But it can also be accompanied by very barbarian notions, more especially in the heads of those who are as much interested, practically, in the process of making value beget value, as they are in misunderstanding that process theoretically. Such people may get the notion into their heads that our spinner, for example, produces or replaces in the first 8 hours of his working day the value of the cotton, in the following hour and 36 minutes the value of the instruments of labor worn away, in the next hour and 12 minutes the value of the wages, and that he devotes to the production of surplus value for the manufacturer only that well-known last hour. In this way the poor spinner is made to perform the twofold miracle, not only of producing cotton, spindles, steam engine, coal, oil, etc., at the same time that he spins with them, but also of turning one working day into 5. For, in the example we are considering, the production of the raw materials and instruments of labor demands 4 working days of 12 hours each, and their conversion into yarn requires another such day. That the love of lucre induces an easy belief in such miracles, and that sycophant doctrinaires are never wanting to prove them, is vouched for by the following incident of historical celebrity. End of section 25.